So you're here to see the RC conversion of the Mobius flying sub, FS-1, from Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea. Let's head to the secret laboratory. Just a short jog. Just around the corner up here. Nearly there. Okay, this is it. Hi, buddy. One of these days I gotta make an easier way to get in here. And here she is. Here is my RC conversion. Now, you were probably thinking it was going to be the bigger 1/32nd scale, but no, this is the 1/128th scale. Let me switch cameras and get a better angle. Okay, that's better. So here it is. This is the Mobius 1/128th scale flying sub from Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea. This is how the kit comes. You can still buy this on Amazon or at a hobby shop. And they are not expensive. This kit is only about $16 to $20. And it's in scale with the much larger Sea View, the main boat from Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea. In fact, the Sea View kit actually comes with the model. And the one that I built, I took out of this box, although, just to keep the kit complete, I bought another one, and the box came very squashed. Oddly enough, the one that came with the Sea View was molded in kind of a white-gray, and the one that came separately is yellow, which would have been nicer. This is the interior for the flying sub that comes with the kit. But it did not come with this one that came in the big box with the Sea View. Anyway, the idea for this project came about because I bought several very inexpensive toy RC submarines off of Amazon just to play around with. And I was surprised. They worked really good. Let me show you a few of them. I got three different ones. This one actually works pretty well. It's got a propeller that is facing up and down, as well as two that are facing to the back. And that's how you steer, is by running one motor or the other. And then to dive, the propeller drives it down. The very best of these toy submarines, these cheap toy submarines, that I think works way better than the others, is this one. This one's pretty common. They're on eBay, Amazon, probably a lot of other places. They're less than $30. It's got an actual working ballast tank. Totally incredible. And it controls the depth great. And it has a propeller for fore and aft, and then another propeller that you can't see that makes it turn. But the one that inspired me to make this flying sub is this one. And you can see, it already looks kind of like the flying sub. So I bought two of these, and these were the cheapest. You can find these as cheap as about $16. And it works pretty well. You get it out of the box, you throw it in the bathtub or a pool or something, and right away it works, and you think, boy, this is pretty fun. I can't believe it's this good for that cheap. But both of them that I had, within a minute, you start to notice that they seem to be spending more time closer to the bottom of the pool. And before long, they're on the bottom. And you know what that means? They leak. So it gradually takes on water, and it's less and less fun. Although it never hurt the electronics. It always stayed working. So I took them apart. I tried adding some sealant around all the areas where water could get in. Didn't seem to make any difference. So I'm not really sure where the water was getting in. But I didn't really care too much, because I knew that I was going to use them to make other things. It also has a pretty bad characteristics. It doesn't turn great. It's hard to control the depth. It's sort of all over the place. But I got the idea to make a flying sub in 1/128 scale because it's so similar looking. I think you can see they're nearly the same size. The flying sub is a little smaller. The interior area of the flying sub is a lot less. This has a pretty big compartment in it. And the flying sub is absolutely tiny. So I forgot to take any videos while I was making this, but I have a few pictures I'll put in here. So the way this works is magnets hold it together. This is your entire watertight compartment. It's just this little area here. This polycarbonate Lexan lid is what keeps the water out for where you gain access to work on it. And you can, in fact, I don't really want to pull it apart if I don't have to, but you can, in fact, get all of the parts out of that hole, including the battery, which is a tiny 2.4-volt lithium ion. The circuit board will fit through the hole, and the two motors, they're glued in there, but I have actually replaced one. In fact, you can see I cut a hole here and pushed it out. I kind of messed it up pushing propellers onto it because I was trying different propellers. I didn't really need to cut that hole, I found out later. I was able to just pull them out through the front without doing that. So over on the side here, this is your test port. So this is just a little plug. This is so you can plug a hose into it and blow in it and test for leaks. And these little metal prongs are the charging port. It's this one that says red and yellow. Originally I had it on this side and I moved it. That's why it says red and yellow over there too. And then these two here are actually what turn it on. When they detect water, the water shorts them just enough that there's a circuit that turns the radio on. And that actually works really, really well. So on the front here, it's probably very hard to see. Camera probably won't focus that close. I have a little picture of Captain Crane and Admiral Nelson from Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea, so that when you put it together, oops, there you go. Well, yeah, it's not showing up so good. You can actually see them in there at the controls. The propellers that I used on here, now obviously the flying sub was rocket or jet powered or nuclear, they don't really ever fully explain it, but it doesn't have propellers. These actually came from one of the other submarines that I took apart. The ones that came with this model are these three-bladed black propellers, which work great, but I was trying to make them more invisible, so I went with clear. And I had to extend the shafts a little bit because they were too close to the hull and you didn't get very much propulsion because it couldn't really get any water in there. So that's why they're extended slightly. And one is turning clockwise and the other one's counterclockwise. This is the only control you have over the sub at all. And this is the transmitter. So I'm still using the stock transmitter that came with this toy sub. It works surprisingly well. So basically, you've got forwards and backwards, left and right. If you go forwards, both propellers turn. And if you go left or right, only the outside one turns. But here's the magic, is this little button on top. It's supposed to be the dive button, or it's kind of the boost button. Now, with the way the toy came, when you hit that boost button, there was no telling what it would do. It would usually dive, but sometimes it would just go up or down or just go straight. The flying sub, it very predictably dives every time, and in fact, you'll see its famous party trick. It'll do a complete outside loop if the conditions are right. But it's amazingly controllable how you can control the depth and the turning and do its one trick, the outside loop, pretty reliably every time. It's a lot of fun to play with, and so far it's been reliable. The little tiny motors that they use, I don't know that they'll last. They might require replacement after a couple seasons or maybe even one season. I don't know. I don't know how watertight they are. Seem okay so far, but time will tell. But you can buy those by themselves. In fact, here, I'll show you. These are the motors. Pretty tiny. They, I bought these on Amazon for, I think, $6 for five of them. And these are rated at 3.7 volts. This is actually only 2.4 volts. But I don't think it makes much difference. I'm sure they'd work fine. And replacing motors isn't that hard. And I don't know that it will need it, but just in case. So the way that this is ballasted, this is the bottom half. You've got this lead weight here, which I smooshed with a hammer on the vise. And you can see it's kind of off to one side. It's just stuck down with butyl tape or, you know, like the, well, I'll show you that too. ...3M caulk strip. This is sort of meant for automotive. You can buy this stuff. They often call it for RV windows, and it's usually gray. This is black, and this stuff is way stickier than the gray stuff I've found. And that's also what's holding the hatch down. So when you want to open it, you just peel it up. You can actually kind of reuse the stuff, or usually I scrape it off with a little razor blade and then put a new layer down and then squish it down and then just trim the excess. But that's also what's holding on the little photograph in the front. And it's what's holding this weight on. And that proved to be a pretty clever move, because you can just shift the weight around. It's just stuck down with this tape. So you can squish it forward or backwards. So as I was trimming it, I just moved it around. And the reason it's off to one side is because all of these details, the pins for the turning it on and off and charging and the port for testing it, they're all on one side. So the weight, you can see, is actually on the opposite side to counterbalance that. Telephone. Okay, so you're probably wondering, well, does it work? Prove it. Let's go to the video of it in the pool, and we'll see how she does. Underwater. Thank you. as you can see, it does work quite well. I have a lot more footage of it underwater, but it was all very much the same, so I figured that was enough. You could see how it works. One thing you probably noticed is that I'm pulsing the power on and off to control the speed and the rate that it turns. I tend to push the buttons, you know, like that. And that's because it's not proportional. So basically, if you hit the forward button, for example, you're just going at full throttle, other than this boost button, which makes the motors go faster. So in order to control the depth and the speed and the rate at which you turn, you have to pulse the motors on and off. But it works very effectively. In one part of the video, you probably saw that it actually got stuck to the ladder for the pool, which is steel, of course. Well, the magnets that hold the bottom and the top half of the hull together are quite powerful. And I realized later, because I got stuck to the ladder a couple more times, I realized that if you just press the boost button, it had enough power to break free without actually going and touching it. So it was kind of a fun thing to avoid, an obstacle. So you can imagine the flying sub from Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea avoiding some kind of treacherous monster or enemy of some kind. Well, that's anything steel that's in the pool. So this one other thing I forgot to mention earlier is that this is the stand that comes with the kit, and I added some lead to it, but it still wasn't enough. The submarine is heavy enough that it still tips forward. So that's why you've got this extra piece on the bottom to make the stand a little bit larger, and that's enough to hold it. So it makes kind of a nice display that you can easily take it on and off of. So there you have it. A fun, very cheap project that didn't take me too long. I think if I was to make another one, I could do it a lot faster. And even though I'm not really old enough to remember Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea when it was new, I remember it when I was a kid in reruns right after I moved to America. It was on, and I remember it being kind of a highlight, and I still like the show. So very, very fun. Very fun, cool project. Thanks for watching. I do have another submarine that I'm working on that will be coming up soon. It's another one of these very small mini subs based on the one I said was the best of the toy submarines, the Submarine, and it's something that I'm converting that's kind of close to me, that's a bit more elaborate than this one. Hopefully it works, and I look forward to a video of that soon. Thanks very much. Bye for now.